Let's get more opinions on the Duterte administration's intensified campaign against corruption. Joining us now is Timario Rivera. He's the chairman of the Center for People Empowerment and Governance. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us this morning.
Good morning, Christian. Thank you for inviting me.
Okay. Of course, no one would argue that this is a step in the right direction to try to weed out corruption, despite the timing, despite the issues raised against it. But is this the way to do it if we want to actually achieve some long-term reforms or impact in our campaign against corruption?
Yes. Well, unfortunately, as we all know, corruption is endemic to our system. And we are working right now under very severe constraints. As you know, President Duterte's term actually ends in, 16 months or so. Moreover, we are facing a major crisis, the COVID-19 pandemic. And another important constraint that would soon overwhelm us would be the coming elections in 2022. All of these are important factors. Now, having said that, of course, we welcome any move to confront corruption, but we need to clearly prioritize, I think, given these constraints. No? We cannot be pursuing like a shotgun approach. So we need to clarify and prioritize clearly which sectors and what kinds of functions do we need to address first, no? And I have in mind, for instance, given these constraints, the prioritization of the delivery of very important services in the face of the pandemic. And this would naturally include health services, social services that are our most marginalized and deprived families and communities need. All of this should be on top of our list. No.
Okay. But in terms of the campaign against corruption itself, you mentioned that the approach should not be a shotgun approach, right? So
yes.
What should be the prioritization here? Because the task force itself already identified specific agencies that would be the focus of the investigation.
Well, again, yes, we need to identify those particular agencies. But my point is there are problems that can be that cannot be resolved easily given the time constraints that we are now facing. Consider, for instance, the DPWH problem. No? Now, all of us will agree that much of the corruption has taken place there. This is not only taking place under this administration. It has been there for all administrations. Why? Because it is a complex problem involving not only the department personnel, but involving other agencies of the government. Congress is implicated in that, for instance, in the way the budget appropriation is conducted. Powerful private contractors are implicated. Local government units are implicated. So, whereas we will not ignore the DPWH, I think my point is, given our constraints, which agencies and which kinds of functions should be prioritized. Moreover, if we're speaking of long-term solutions, I think one glaring omission has been the participation of the people themselves, of the communities involved, of watchdogs. No, this is an important component for any long-term campaign against corruption also. No?
Okay. Now, how exactly do you make that work? Because this is also being done in other countries, in more advanced democracies. An honest-to-goodness participation by the people to make sure that there would be greater transparency, at the same time, feedback from the communities, right? But in this case,
yes.
How should we do it if we want to do it right?
Well, again, One is ensuring greater transparency in our processes. Now, unfortunately, up to now, as we also all know, we don't have an FOI law, no? There is an FOI executive memorandum, but it only covers the executive agencies. But not only that, even the ombudsman is in its latest pronouncement has severely restricted access, for instance, to very important documents like the SALN, which would be another important mechanism for ensuring transparency. No? We also need to institutionalize what is known as a system of social audits, where citizens, not only the commission and audit, in other words, the commission and audit performs a very important function, no doubt about that. But, in this particular case, we really need a whole of government, whole of society approach. Now, if I remember right, some indicators of this more active citizen participation would be also in the auditing and monitoring process. Mm-hmm. It can be done at various aspects of the governmental process. In the budgeting, for instance, we do have a practice known as participative budgeting.
Yeah.
And it can be done. It can be initiated in starting at the LGUs. No? The late Mayor Jesse Robredo, I think, was a leader in this particular case. No? So the budgeting process, the monitoring process of even the DPWH anti-corruption mechanisms can include a social audit and social monitoring process. Not in the actual procurement itself.
Okay.
Because again, the procurement is one vulnerable area, as we all know, where a lot of non-transparency and corruption take place.
So in this case, how would you characterize this latest approach by the president? Because I'm asking these questions. I keep on asking these questions because it seems like people or governments or administrations here in the Philippines have this tendency or proclivity to always come up with a task force whenever a big problem comes up. And afterward, the same problems reemerges, or the same problems reemerge. So in this case, how would you characterize this latest approach?
Yes, a task force has its strengths and weaknesses. I think the strength is, of course, hopefully it might encourage greater coordination among different and multiple stakeholders, initially with government. No? Its weakness, however, is, given our severe time and resource constraints, there are certain problems requiring immediate attention and resolution, which could be postponed or which could take an unusually long time. No? And that is why one aspect of the prioritization is to clearly identify, you know, where we should start. And for instance, to be more specific, the DOH and the PhilHealth, no, could be one important point where we can focus our drive against corruption, because they are mandated to provide a very important and a very immediate function and service that is crucial in the face of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. The same thing with the delivery of services, no? Because take a look, for instance, at the problem of PhilHealth. I think the problem, and I'm referring to the grant of the so-called interim management fee?
Interim reimbursement mechanism.
Yes. And if we take a look at that, it was clearly a case of a few powerful officials going, identifying their preferred recipients, even if later on we found out that they were not performing the kind of functions, no, that would have merited this kind of assistance or special disbursement. So the right within the department, you can institute the a more clear vetting and auditing mechanism, no? That would require the less intervention from other departments. That is what I'm trying to say. Whereas in a problem like DPWH, you really require a multiple stakeholder coordination there, no? Or something that happened with the delivery of social services. Remember the problem with DSWD, no? We now know that one aspect of the problem was the absence of an updated data showing a more comprehensive listing, for instance, of the truly poor and marginalized families. Now, why aren't we able to do that? We could do that. We can have a very focused process of identifying them and using the technology that will definitely hasten this process. No?
Okay.
Yung ID system natin, matagal na rin dapat ginawa yan. No? Mm-hmm. So all of these are, I think, doable, no? Within the time constraints that we are looking at.
So they should identify the low-hanging fruits that
well,
can
yeah,
be achieved
you can,
right
you
away.
Can put
okay.
it in that sense. Yes.
Now, let's talk about credibility here and also the political capital of the president. Of course, based on a recent survey, the president still enjoys the support and approval of 9 out of 10 Filipinos. That's very high at this stage in his administration. But some are also might be thinking that why should we believe you now when you are on your way out and you were not able to do a lot in this respect since 2016? I mean, how do you contend with perspectives like that?
Well, yes. I wish we had more time to discuss the problems of public surveys. But
we can talk about that in greater detail in another interview.
Yes. Without going into the complex methodological issues, no? If indeed that is the current sentiment, perhaps it can show that there is that people perceive some degree of levels of insulation from responsibility, meaning that, for instance, in the concrete cases of the PhilHealth problem that we experience, and also with the ayuda, no, yung provision of the ayuda through DSWD or even local government officials, the public sentiment and perception might be that these are the leaders of these agencies are primarily responsible, and perhaps not so much at the level of the president. So that is one aspect that we can look into, no?
Okay. Professor Temi Rivera, thank you for joining us, sir.
Thank you. Thank you also, Christian. Yes.